everybody. This is Elizabeth with Tea with Jesus for this week. And we're going to be continuing to work through our study in Philippians. And I think that today we'll be able to continue to go through the first chapter and probably be able to certainly finish it today. We have talked in the last few studies that, get a quick drink. In the last few studies that Philippians 1, verse 6, that we can be confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work and you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. That the work that God is doing in our life, he is going to keep working and he will finish what he has started, which is wonderful. And then we went on and as we talked and got to verse 21, for to me to live is Christ and to die is gain. And to be able to know that no matter what happens in our life, it's going to have meaning and value in eternity because of the value that Jesus gives it. And that even if we lose our life, we're going to be with him, and that is gain. And so I'm going to go ahead and start actually this week at verse 21 and go on from there as we move our way through this wonderful first chapter in the book of Philippians. Verse 21. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But if I live on in the flesh, this will mean fruit from my labor, yet what I shall choose I cannot tell. For I am hard pressed between the two, having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better. Nevertheless, to remain in the flesh is more needful for you. And being confident of this, I know that I shall remain and continue with you for all your progress and joy of faith, that your rejoicing for me may be more abundant in Jesus Christ by my coming to you again. So he was really hoping to be able to go back and see them again. I did some research in Acts, and he's under like a house arrest at this time in Rome and not able to leave. But he's hoping to be able to go and join the people in Philippi. And then he goes on in verse 27. Only let your conduct be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear of your affairs, that you stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel, and not in any way terrified by your adversaries, which is to them a proof of perdition, but to you of salvation, and that from God. For to you it has been granted on behalf of Christ, not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for his sake, having the same conflict which you saw in me, and now here is in me. And then he's going to go on in the beginning of chapter 2 to talk about how he wants them to be living and how he wants them to be treating each other. But I'm going to go ahead and we're going to take a few minutes to talk today about what is he's talking about here, verses 27 through 30. And, you know, Paul knew what it was to be persecuted for his love for Jesus, for his faith in Christ. He had been a persecutor, and now he is being persecuted. And he knows that the people in Philippi could be very definitely facing persecution for their faith. I love where he says here in verse 28, and not in any way be terrified by your adversaries. He wants them, in verse 27, to stand fast in one spirit, with one mind striving together for the faith of the gospel, and not in any way terrified by your adversaries, which is to them a proof of perdition, but to you of salvation, and that from God. We have to realize that in this really greatly beautiful world that God has made and given us, that this really is a kind of a war zone. Satan is real. He is just nothing compared to the mighty power of Jesus, very Son of God, Jesus God himself. Satan is nothing compared to him. But he is at work in this world. And we are in a battle because God is doing everything possible to try to draw people to him and to his hope. And Satan is doing everything possible to deceive people and lie to them and get them to think they can't trust God and get them to think they have to do it on their own and to get them to think that they are bound by the sins that they struggle with, or that they're hopeless, or that they should be in despair. All these lies, he is the father of lies. And God is wanting so much for all of us to see the clarity of his love and light and truth. So we are definitely in a warfare. And we know right now for many people, you know, in our world, that warfare is very real. They are really truly suffering because of their faith in Jesus. And I know that God gives them strength, that God gives them the grace that they need for the moment, and that they, if they lose their lives, are going to just go to be with him in incredible glory. But we have to realize that we are going to be in a warfare because of how much Satan wants to hurt us, because of how much he hates God. And God is mighty on our behalf. And he wants to give us his joy and peace and hope, even in the midst of struggles. And so he says here he doesn't want the people in Philippi to be terrified by their adversaries. Their salvation is going to be from God. And the adversaries, and you know, there is proof of perdition. In other words, they are truly headed for a very bad end. The enemy, Satan, is eventually headed for a very bad end. He says in verse 29, "For you it has been granted on behalf of Christ, not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for his sake, having the same conflict which you saw in me, and now here is in me." And I'm going to go and just read two more verses as we go into chapter 2. "Therefore," because of what he just said, "if there is any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and mercy, fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind." And even when life has struggles, the world is damaged, and we can have illness, and we can have people mistreat us. People who have been wounded tend to wound others unless they let God heal them. And we also, the enemy goes about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. But we know we can be safe with our Lord. We don't have to be afraid of the enemy at all. And we can bring consolation and comfort to each other. We can cling to the Lord and have his comfort and his presence and his peace. And one of the things that's really on my heart a lot, you know, living in America, we are increasingly finding that it's not politically correct to even say the name of Jesus or to stand up for who he is in our lives, and that he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He is the only way, the truth, and the life. He is who he says he is. That has become very politically incorrect. And I know that in many places people are actually suffering greatly for the sake of his name. Well, I'm really feeling very challenged that I don't want to be shy in any way at all, or scared or nervous, to proclaim who Jesus is in my life and who I know him to be. And there's no doubt about who you're talking about if you say the name Jesus, because he is the only name under heaven by which man can be saved. And I know that just as Paul was bringing them comfort, the Lord wants us to have comfort and to know that we can simply trust him no matter what this world is going to bring. I really believe things are going to start getting a lot tougher. And, you know, our basic YouTube channel for Bill and I is Tiny House Preppers. We really believe it's important to just be prepared, just to have some things ready. Because we don't know what all is going to really come. But I really believe, and I believe the Bible says, things are going to get kind of rough, get worse. But God will shine brighter. His power will be brighter. His grace, his love, his strength, his hope will just get that much greater. The light will shine brighter if things get darker. And so I find a lot of comfort in this. It's been granted on behalf of Christ, not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for his sake, having the same conflict which you saw in me, and now here is in me. But if there's any consolation in Christ, comfort of love, fellowship of the Spirit, affection, mercy, he's asking them to fulfill his joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord and of one mind. And to all the people that come and share this time with me, I want you to know that the Lord is mighty on your behalf. And he is a comforter. The Holy Spirit has been given to us as a comforter. And we don't ever, ever have to live in fear, no matter what we we encounter in this world or in our life. And ultimately, the Lord knows what the outcome of everything is going to be, and that there's a happy ending. And we can be confident of that. And we can know that this is just a breath compared to all the eternity that we're going to be able to spend with him. And that everything here that we love is just a tiny foreshadowing of what he's been preparing for us. And he said, I'm going to go to John. And I think I'll go to 14. Let me just get this very quickly here. We can know not only that he's with us here, and he loves us, and he can bring so much joy to our lives. But let's go to the words that Jesus spoke to his disciples in John 14. And we'll start at the first verse. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know. So Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you're going, and how can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him and have seen him. And Jesus said over and over again, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. You know, I will bring you with me. I'll bring you to myself. So he has sent us the Holy Spirit, who is with us, God in us. And we know that no matter what happens, ultimately we're going to go to be with him. And that is a wonderful truth to know. So next week, I'm going to continue on in Philippians 2. This book just gets better and better. I did watch a thing recently about Starry Hilder, and please pray for her. She's doing really well, but there's been apparently some really bad tears in her arm, and her neck is having some struggles with the healing that it needs. And as those nerves are really regenerating, it makes her pretty miserable at times. And they're even going to have to do a bone graft so that she can get her tooth back. That she's really trusting God, and I've seen ways that God reassured her ahead of time that he'd be with her. And so I just appreciate your prayers for her. Thank you for your prayers for us. We appreciate it, and we love you so much for it. Let's pray. Father, thank you that no matter what comes, that you hold us strongly. You hold us in the palm of your hand. You've said in Romans that nothing can take us away from you. And so, Lord, I just pray that that we will all stand up strong, and we will in no way ever be ashamed of your name. That we can proclaim to the world that you are the hope that it needs so badly. So, Lord, I just pray that we will learn from the Philippians book here what you want us to learn. And God, I just trust it to you. And for anyone out there, Lord, who is living in fear, oh God, once again, I pray, just saturate them with your presence and your love. And I know that will cast the fear away. Thank you, Lord, that we can trust you no matter what. And I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Love you guys. Thank you for your incredible comments. You're just wonderful, wonderful people. And I pray that God will be able to do all in your lives that his love has ever intended. So I will see you next week, and thank you. I'll see you again.